Welcome to this class, which provides an overview about modern policy search. First, about a word about modern policy search. I would have called it first deep policy search, as we are speaking about deep reinforcement learning. But a few colleagues pointed to the fact that the neural networks used in reinforcement learning are not deep. So maybe saying deep policy search is not a good idea, though this is what is done in most of the field. Okay, so what's the purpose of this video? First, it comes after a policy gradient class, which is available here, and you should have a look at this video before looking to the one you are currently listening to. So the purpose of this video is to provide an overview of state-of-the-art reinforcement learning algorithms, particularly in the continuous action case. I won't cover the discrete action case, as I will say later on. In the first part of this video, I will present a lot of algorithms, and each algorithm will be presented just in one slide with a link to a dedicated video. And in these videos, you will have more details about these algorithms. Then the most interesting part probably is the part where I will present to you different perspectives so as to organize the field into subdomains, so as to relate the algorithms to each other. So first I will take the on-policy versus off-policy perspective, then the deadly triad perspective, sorry. Then the continuous action Q-learning perspective, and finally I will say a word about distributional reinforcement learning, which is a class of algorithm that I don't know how to organize with the rest yet. And finally I will give you a few general conclusions and some perspective or opening towards interesting subfields. So let's start with this messy picture. Okay, here I have tried to organize all the algorithms into a broad picture, so everything is starting from the policy gradients class that I have given before. Okay, and then I will say a word about CACLA and then organize those different ideas into... Okay, you will see that. The important point, as I said, is that I won't cover the discrete action case, so I won't cover DQN, which is treated in the video, nor Rainbow, etc. And in my opinion, but that's my opinion, you may disagree, the algorithms that every reinforcement learning student should know are A3C, DDPG, TD3, PPO, and SAC. Okay, and those two, TD3 and SAC, are the most used nowadays because they are the closest to... Okay, they are state of the art, let's say. First, a small word about this ancestor. So that CACLA algorithm was from Hado van der Selt and Marco Viering, okay? And it's an old stuff, okay? That's before the emergence of deep reinforcement learning. But it was already doing things, interesting things in the continuous action case. And we could say that a few algorithms, more recent algorithms, are taking some ideas coming from there. In particular, one interesting thing that they do is that, you know, there is this temporal difference signal delta, which is used to update the critic and then the actor in reinforcement learning algorithms. And what they do with a quite interesting argument in CACLA is that they just update when delta is positive. They say that when delta is positive, you should reinforce the action that you have taken. But when delta is negative, it's not necessarily a good idea to move away from the current action because you don't know in which direction to move. Okay, so they just update when delta is positive. And that's an idea which is re-emerging at the moment in algorithms like AWR or different things. Okay. Then, historically, important algorithms that were presented after the standard policy gradient approach are A2C and A3C. Let's say that A2C and A3C is the direct follow-up of my policy gradient class, where you are just trying to learn a critic and to apply an actor-critic algorithms to applying the policy gradient ID. But as you will see, there are some interesting ideas. First, so it's a straightforward implementation of the actor-critic policy gradient approach. It will learn the value function v as a critique through temporal difference estimates. Okay. And add then, and that's interesting, it adds an entropy regularization term to favor exploration. But as I will say later on, the way it is added, this entropy regularization term, is not the same way as in star factor critique or SAC. In SAC, this is done much more deeply. Okay. So the gradient is just trying to optimize this standard policy gradient term plus beta times some entropy term. Okay. And in fact, here you just take the gradient of this entropy term. So you are just adding two gradients, whereas in SAC, you are just taking the gradient of the whole sum, where here you don't have a gradient term. Okay. And then A3C is an asynchronous version of A2C with many actors. Okay. So let's say that A3C was one of the first large-scale attempts of DeepMind to use reinforcement learning with many actors, and it was already having some interesting results. But the point is that when using A3C, they do not use a replay buffer. They consider that using asynchrony between the actors ensures that you have more independent and identically distributed samples. Okay, which means that your samples are not so correlated. So this will have the same property as in DDPG, where you shuffle a replay buffer. Here you don't have a replay buffer, but you use asynchrony to have uncorrelated samples. And it uses also n-step return, whereas the use of this n-step return is not so clear because they don't have a replay buffer, so it's not clear in my mind how they do so. And this algorithm was designed to be on policy as it's a standard policy gradient technique. Okay, so that's an ancestor, but okay, that's an ancestor from 2016, okay? But that's already an important algorithm. After A2C and N3C, then an important algorithm is TRPO. So TRPO has a completely different design principle. So it's based on Monte Carlo estimates rather than temporal difference estimates. So it's a Monte Carlo approach to the policy gradient. It uses a surrogate gradient with some importance sampling. Okay, let's say first that in fact for those algorithms, you should have a look at the dedicated video here, where I will explain those details. I will explain this in detail. And as you will see in this video, it enforces a natural gradient constraint to maintain exploration while keeping close to the previous policies. So again, it's a lot on policy because it wants to keep close to the previous policy. And in TRPO, John Shulman is using a conjugate gradient optimization approach, which scales rather well to the use of large neural networks. After TRPO, you have PPO and ACTOR. Okay. So in the PPO paper, you have two algorithms that are defined. The general idea is to forget the conjugate gradient approach because those conjugate gradient approaches are not available in standard tensor libraries. So one is using a soft constraint, some kind of regularization with a regularization factor on the trust region, okay. And the second algorithm is using rather the clip importance sampling loss function, okay. So it's using clipping, and both algorithms can use standard gradient descent techniques, so they can be easily implemented with the tensor libraries like TensorFlow or PyTorch. And finally, John Shulman also proposed the generalized advantage estimator, which shows the equivalence between using some kind of n-step return or lambda return instead of using standard Monte Carlo. Okay. After PPO, so ACTOR was proposed. So ACTOR is also derives also from TRPO. So it's close to TRPO, but instead of using a conjugate gradient method, it uses block diagonal estimation of a Hessian matrix, so it uses a second order method, whereas a TRPO uses a first order one. Okay, and actor can be seen as TRPO with this connector factored approximated curvature, which is a way to compute a natural gradient using a second order technique. Okay, again, this is explained in the same video as PPO and TRPO. A completely different family is DDPG, so that's deep deterministic policy gradient, and the important word here is deterministic. So whereas all what we have seen before was using stochastic policies, here they use a deterministic policy. This is due to a paper from David Silver where it shows how you can compute the gradient of a deterministic policy. Okay. And it uses several tricks from DQN, so it uses a replay buffer and it shuffles the samples in the replay buffer so as to decorrelate them. Okay. And it's also using target networks so as to stabilize the approximation in the network. One issue with DDPG is that it suffers from overestimation bias. I will show you this about TD3 just on the next slide. Okay. And it's claimed to be off policy, but you have to be aware that in fact off policy in deep reinforcement learning is a relative notion. They are not completely off policy, so you cannot train them with any behavioral policy. Okay. You have to use behavior policy which is close to the policy you are trying to train. Okay. And because it uses a replay buffer, it's much more sample efficient than on-policy techniques, but it's more unstable. Okay. And you can see my dedicated video about DPG, which is by far my most seen video. So it's okay, I have a lot of nice feedback about this video. So TD3 is the follow-up of DDPG, so that's from Scott Fujimoto, and that's 2018. So the idea is that in DDPG, as you can see here, the Q values can get higher than what they should. Okay, in fact, the optimal Q, max Q values should be around 60 on that particular problem. I don't remember which it is. But you can see that for a time, the Q values are overshooting. Okay, and this is due to some overestimation bias. Okay, so in TD3, they just propose to use two critics and to take the mean between those two critics so as to counter the overestimation bias. And this works quite well. So TD3 performs on par with soft actor critique that we will see later on. And sometimes it is better, sometimes it is worse. Okay. And whether TD3 will outperform SAC depends on the environment. And this paper studies the impact of entropy regularization and it gives some hints on the fact that some environments need entropy regularization, in which case SAC will be probably better, and some don't, in which case TD3 may be better. Okay. I don't have a video about this algorithm, but if you know a lot about DDPG and just read the paper, that's easy to get this algorithm. Okay, now I am moving to a completely different family of algorithms. That's the IPG framework, which tries to combine on-policy techniques and off-policy techniques. So the first one in this family is QPROP, okay? And it's starting from TRPO, and it's using a control variate approach so as to be more off-policy. So it integrates deterministic and stochastic policy gradient using a control variate formalization. Let's say you would have a deterministic policy gradient part and a stochastic policy gradient part, and you would tune the impact of those two gradients. So doing so, it integrates on-policy Monte Carlo policy gradient methods and off-policy actor critique methods into a single framework, and it will perform one or the other depending on some hyperparameter. Okay, and the control variate ID comes from that paper. The other algorithm from this IPG framework is ACER, okay, and it builds on more stuff. Okay, so it's using A3C as a baseline, let's say, as a fundamental algorithm, and then it uses truncated importance sampling. So that's the idea of gradient clipping that comes from PPO with bias correction. Okay, and this comes from ideas to be more off policy. Okay, and then it uses stochastic dwelling network. So dwelling network, if you can remember about my DQN video, it's a way to use both the advantage and the action value functions so as to be more efficient in approximating the critique. Okay, and it uses retrace, which is also an important off-policy algorithm to perform off-policy and step returns updates. Okay, so the idea is that this algorithm combines many things, but finally, if we have a look at those two algorithms, so that's the interpolated policy gradient framework, the point is that it's too complicated, it has too many hyperparameters. So those algorithms, whereas they are performing well, they are very difficult to use, so they have been mostly forgotten right now. Okay, so that's 3 years ago. Finally, there is the soft actor critique algorithm, which is probably one of the most used at the moment. Okay, that's one of the state of the art algorithm. So it uses, there are two papers. Again, see my video about the history about these papers. So it uses a stochastic policy. It integrates entropy regularization inside the objective function rather than summing two gradients. It's having an objective function which integrates entropy regularization and then it applies policy gradient on this objective function. Okay. It uses two critiques as in TD3, so it takes the idea of TD3 so as to avoid overestimation bias. It uses some n-step return, and again, watch the video if you want to have more details about this algorithm, which is one of the most important at the moment. So to have a big picture about all these algorithms, that's my off-policy versus on-policy perspective. So here you are very on-policy, that's the case of TRPO. Here you are very off-policy, that's the case of AWR, those algorithms that I have not been speaking about until now. You will see more about this. And you see that the more you move towards this direction, the more you are off-policy. The general perspective is that, in general, on-policy algorithms are more stable, but they require more samples because they don't use a replay buffer. Okay, whereas off-policy algorithms are more sample efficient, but they are more unstable. And a lot of research is dedicated to finding the best of both worlds. I have written a lot of current research. I would say that now that TD3 and SAC are the standards, this topic is becoming less important. And let's say that SAC is doing very well under this perspective of combining a replay buffer and some ideas coming from on-policy methods. I must also add that very recently there was this paper which is very interesting because it studies the on-policy techniques with a lot of details and a lot of compute power so as to draw some general lessons about these algorithms. So it's entitled What Matters in On-Policy Reinforcement Learning, a Large-Scale Empirical Study. And if you want to know more about on-policy methods, you should read this paper and you will see that it also covers a few algorithms that are not covered here. Let's change perspective now. My second perspective will be the deadly triad. Okay, so what's the deadly triad? It was proposed in a tutorial from Richard Sutton at NeurIPS in 2015. Okay, it was just an introduction to reinforcement learning with approximation functions. Function approximation. And in that tutorial, Richard Sutton explained that if you combine function approximators of policy learning and bootstrap, so that's using temporal difference methods, then you can run unstable. This was shown, for instance, by Lehman Baird more than 15 years ago now. And this deadly triad effect, the fact that it can be unstable, has been a lot studied in DQN, in the DQN algorithm. But in particular, in this paper from DeepMind, they have shown that if you use DQN in most Atari problems with a lot of different hyperparameter settings, in fact, divergence does not occur much. It may run unstable and converge back to something stable. Okay, so that's studied a lot in of deep Q networks, but this deadly triad is also an issue when you are using continuous actions. So you may encounter the deadly triad too when you are using DDPG or those algorithms that I am covering in this video. So if you want to avoid this deadly triad, you have three options. Either you use no function approximators, so in that case you are in tabular reinforcement learning but you cannot address large problems, or you rather should be on policy so as to avoid being off policy. So that's what you do when you use TRPO, PPO, ACTOR, accuracy, etc. But in that case you are not sample efficient. Or a third option, which is interesting, consists in using no bootstrap, so using rather Monte Carlo methods, and trying to combine off policy and no bootstrap techniques. In fact, I should not have said Monte Carlo. In fact, it's using regression, as you will see. Okay, and I will just cover in the next slide the AWR algorithm, which does not use bootstrap, so it offers an original solution to avoid the deadly triad issue. So what's AWR? Again, I have a dedicated video to this algorithm. So that's an algorithm which approximates an actor and a critic just using standard regression routines. Okay, more precisely, it learns an actor using advantage-weighted regressions. It's using regression towards an advantage. So what does this mean, advantage weighting? It means that you will try to approximate the advantage, but the larger the advantage, the larger the weight you apply to your regression technique. Okay, so the fact that you use regression from samples make it more of policy. But still, in the heart of the algorithm, there is a natural gradient constraint, so it's not truly off policy because you don't want to move too far away from the previous policy. Okay, and in particular, the authors of this paper show that it's also very good at learning from imitation, because you can, instead of starting from a behavioral policy which is random or whatever, you can start from expert samples. And in that case, using regression, you will have a policy that is close to the behavior you want to imitate. And you can also use it in the context of offline learning. If you just perform one iteration of regression, you don't iterate again. Okay, then you are just offline. You just use what you have in your replay buffer, and that's it. A third perspective about this algorithm is about finding a maximum in a continuous action state. So let's come back to DQN or even Q-learning. So in Q-learning, your update rule is as follows. Okay, you will update your Q-values with that particular temporal difference term. And in the temporal difference term, you have to perform a max over actions of the Q-value of the next state among the potential actions. And in fact, if you want to perform this update, you have two things that become too hard. First, computing this max becomes an optimization problem because your action space is now a space and you have to find a max of a function in over the space. Okay. And the second point that is becoming too hard is selecting action just by finding the max. Okay, when you are playing your policy, you want to decide what to do and you will just pick the action which has the highest Q value. But again, here, if your action space is continuous, then this is an optimization problem. Okay, so you have one optimization problem so as to update your critique, and one optimization problem so as to select your action. And you have the same issues in Q-learning, but in Q-learning, your action space is discrete, so that's easy to find a max. So if you look from this perspective, you will see that you have four classes of solutions. One here consists in using an model in which finding the max is easy. That's the case of NAF, where your policy is just a quadratic function, so it's easy to find the maximum of a quadratic function. A second perspective consists in sampling from a limited set of actions. You have a continuous action space, but you just take a subset of these actions and you find the max in the subsets. That's what QtOpt is doing. Okay. The first is DDPG, is to train a side estimator of the best action, and the side of the estimator of this best action is your actor. I will show you that in fact your actor just tells you one action, and this action is a good approximate of the max action. And finally, in SAC, you can train a stochastic sampler of the best action, so that's as in DDPG, but it will provide you with several samples of best action, and then you can choose in this family. Okay, so now let's cover those algorithms. So in NAF, they have sophisticated neural network architecture which implements some, okay, that's not truly neural networks because this is just implementing equations with tensors. The neural networks are just there. Okay, so you have a mu network here, which is your actor, and then you make so that your actor will provide a quadratic function. Okay, and NAF was shown to outperform DDPG on some benchmarks. They are using several tricks that I won't cover, such as using model-based reinforcement learning, etc. And it was used in real robotic settings for MSR success. But the general point is that having an actor which maximizes a quadratic function is not general enough for many problems. Your critique will be far away from quadratic, so your approximate will be very poor and it won't work. Okay, that's the general idea. So QtOpt is doing something different. The general idea, as I said, is to sample a set of actions in the action space and to take the max over these sampled actions. Okay. And to sample those actions, so to find the best action in a set, they are using the cross-entropy method, okay, which is an evolution strategy method. Okay, and the idea is that they just take two iterations of the cross-entropy method, which will provide several actions. So if you just take 64 actions in your population, then with two iterations you will just consider those many actions and you will take the best six samples in this population. Okay, and just by doing this, instead of looking really for the max, you just take the max over those actions, then you get something which is quite efficient and that can be used so as to grasp things in the robotic setups. Okay. So the DDPG approach, as I told you, you can see that it's exactly looking, okay, the actor is used as an approximator of the max. As I already explained in my DDPG video, in DQN you just have to select one action by taking the max over the Q values, but you have a discrete set of actions. In DDPG you have a critique and then you have the actor. And here to take the max, in fact, you take the Q value of the next state and the action considered by the actor. So it means that you hope that your actor here will provide you with the max action. Okay, so if your policy is close to the max, then you are close to Q-learning because this is close to taking the max action in that particular state. And the idea is that you will use the gradient of the Q-values over the action so as to update the actor weight so that they get closer and closer to the max. Okay, and this idea comes from the NFQCA. Okay, again, have a look at my DDPG video, but this particular perspective is not that explained in my DDPG video. Okay, that was the end of my third family. I didn't say it, but in SAC you are using the same trick as in DDPG, but your policy is stochastic, though, so you get max samples. So a final word about distributional reinforcement learning, because this is an important topic that has received a lot of attention in last years. So what's the general idea of the C51 algorithm and this distributional perspective? The idea is that instead of having one reward per state, you have a distribution of rewards over each state, and you will represent explicitly this distribution of rewards, so either using an histogram, so a categorical representation, or using a mixture of Gaussians, whereas in standard reinforcement learning you just have a scalar value. So using this approach, trying to approximate a distribution of rewards, leads to what is called the distributional policy gradient, which is studied in that particular paper. And okay, it gives rise to interesting theoretical puzzles and concepts, so as this corresponds to using a Wasserstein matrix. And in the paper they explain to you that if you go into the maths, it should not work as good as it does, but it works in practice better than standard reinforcement learning in several setups. Okay, and an important follow-up that is rather recent is that the same authors, together with computational neuroscience authors such as Matthew Botvinnik, studied the biological plausibility of this idea of using a distribution of reward, and they have some convincing argument in this Nature paper. So the general idea is that in the brain you use a lot of population encoding, and population encoding might be a way to have an explicit representation of the distribution, and you might have a population of encoding of the rewards, so an explicit encoding of the distribution of rewards. That's the general idea about distributional reinforcement learning. So this gave rise of an interesting algorithm which is called D4PG, so that DDPG with 4D, okay, so that deep deterministic distributional policy gradient algorithm. I don't remember what the last D stands for, and they show in that paper that they get some efficient results, and they show in particular that using the L-step return is critical in that particular experiment, and it outperforms PPO, whereas PPO is considered to be more stable. Okay, so let's go now to the synthesis of all these algorithms. Here you can see again my picture where algorithms are organized into the on policy versus off policy approach, but I wanted to show to you that everything started in 2015. That's only 5 years ago, that's not that much, okay, 6 years ago. And I wanted to show, to stress that 2018 was an important year because three algorithms that are considered state of the art were proposed that particular year. So it took about 3 years to get those algorithms more mature. This one is important too because it has applications in robotics. Okay. And since the last year, the focus is more on complementary equations such as studying multitask reinforcement learning, intrinsic motivations, exploration, I will say about this in the end of this video, meta reinforcement learning, etc. But there is still some research on trying to find better algorithms than those. Among the different properties that I have told you about in this video, one is, do the algorithm use n-step return or not? And whether using an n-step return is a good idea or not is an open question, because it's a common ingredient in many state-of-the-art algorithms. But the point is that if you think of it closely, you will see that if your algorithm was off policy, using n-step return will make it a little more on policy. So it's unclear whether it is a good idea in principle to use it, and I just wrote a few weeks ago that a large conclusive study is missing, but there is a very very recent paper that is here which studies experience replay. That, again, this is a topic that is completely understood in the domain, and in the abstract they just mentioned that counterintuitively they show that theoretically ungrounded n-step return are uniquely beneficial while other techniques confer limited benefit. Okay, so it seems that n-step return is very good even though it's theoretically ungrounded and if you don't correct it to be more of policy. Okay, that's the general message from that important paper. Another dimension that you may want to study is whether you are using stochastic policies, Kullback-Leibler divergence or entropy regularization. As I have said, TRPO was using the KL divergence to obtain a natural gradient approach. More recently, SAC proposed entropy regularization, which is a more modern approach so as to favor some exploration in the stochastic policies. You have also the distributional approach here. So the general idea is that stochastic policies are good for exploration because the likelihood on over actions changes more smoothly than with deterministic policies. So this has better properties in terms of convergence, but as I said, those policy gradient methods are more generally on policies, so they are sample inefficient. Using the Kullback-Leibler constraint mostly prevents premature convergence to determinism. Okay, you don't want your policy to become deterministic too early because you may be still away from the optimal, from the global optimum, and that's bad. And the third idea consists in using entropy regularization rather than Kullback-Leibler divergence, and this seems to be the leading approach at the moment because of the supremacy of SAC. So finally, a few words about the domain. One thing that you have to be aware is that if you want to study modern reinforcement learning, you need large computational resources, and that some of these algorithms are quite complicated, so having a team of good engineers around you helps a lot. Okay, so that's one of the reasons why big actors are ruling the game. So in DeepMind, they have plenty strong researchers, but they have also plenty engineers that make a fantastic job in implementing those algorithms. And that's also the case in OpenAI, in Berkeley, in Microsoft, in Facebook, etc. A few years ago, there was a joke that what those companies were using is having a lot of students playing with hyperparameters of these algorithms, and that's even had a name that was said, grad student descent. I find this mind funny, okay? One rather negative side of this research being led by companies is that there is more focus on performance than on understanding. My belief is that this is our role in universities to try to understand why those algorithms work or do not work, whereas in companies they just want something that works as much as possible. Okay. So this has led to some criticism in the field, in particular about what is called the reproducibility crisis, that more and more people were trying to publish papers with better performance than the rest, but that it was not always possible to trust the results because just by playing with the hyperparameters you can get very different results. So this has led in particular to this deep reinforcement learning that matters paper, which is important, which shows that those algorithms are unstable, so they are hard to compare. There is a lot of sensitivity to hyperparameters, and it's hard to perform a study where you just are sure that your algorithm is better than the other one. Okay. Also, a negative aspect is that these empirical comparisons are performed mostly on toy, complicated toy benchmarks such as OpenAI GEM, Mujoco, DeepMind Control Suite, etc., which have no industrial validity. This is not solving some real world problem, but also it's too complicated to analyze deeply what's happening in those benchmark, so this just leads to comparisons of performance, and that's it. And there is, in my opinion, a lack of controlled experiments where you just use really toy problems where you can analyze the impact of changing one particular parameter in your problem so as to see what are the real properties of your algorithms. In the domain, there is still some fast performance progress, but the progress now is more on exploration, multitask learning, curriculum learning, etc., as I already said. Okay, so there is a lot of debate at the moment in the domain about whether we are going in the right track, and probably this race for performance will start to change into something which is more focused on analysis. Let's say that I am optimistic in saying this, but I hope it's true. Okay, so among the different topics that I wanted to open towards, so that's just my opening section, I wanted to have a focus about exploration, which is one of my favorite subdomains in deep reinforcement learning. So exploration, as I said in the opening videos, exploration is central to reinforcement learning. Everything is about the exploration-exploitation trade-off. Okay, as I said, stochastic policy, chiral divergence, and entropy regularization are a way to deal with this exploration issue. But there are reasons to prefer using deterministic policy rather than stochastic ones, because in some real-world application, you don't want your policy to be stochastic. You want to be sure about what your agent will be doing in any situation. Okay. And someday I will make a class about exploration itself, but that's a complicated topic which has many different approaches, and it's hard to give a clear picture about everything about exploration. So I will just point to two works that I have done with my students in the few last years. So one is with Cédric Collat at JPG. The idea was to use some diversity seeking mechanism before using DDPG, and this was studied in the continuous mountain car setting and then on Alpha-Cheetah. And the other one is more recent, that's with Guillaume Matron, that's called PBCS. So in this paper, we are just studying complicated maze navigation experiments, and I would like to draw your attention on the fact that state-of-the-art algorithms such as DDPG, TD3, SAC, etc. are completely unable to solve those kind of tasks. So you need some dedicated exploration algorithms to find a solution in those algorithms. A second point about this opening part is about the combination of evolutionary method and deep reinforcement learning. So I want to point to those two papers that are from 2018 too, okay? And the general idea is that evolutionary methods are more stable and they have some good properties, but deep reinforcement learning methods are more sample efficient. So the idea was to try to combine those techniques, and in those two papers we have two different approaches to the problem. And again, those approaches are a lot related to the exploration issue. Okay, and there is a new tendency this year in particular to look for diversity seeking methods such as novelty search or goal exploration processes, and to combine them with deep reinforcement learning. And on this topic of combining evolutionary methods and deep reinforcement learning, this summer there was already 20 new algorithms starting from those two preliminary works. So if you have any questions about this class, I will be happy to answer them. So just send an email, and thank you for listening. Bye-bye.